program today. My name is Bill Young, and you are watching Faith is a Lifestyle. This week on the broadcast, we're in a little series that I started a few weeks ago that I call Golden Nuggets. And what we're doing in these series is just taking little bite-sized portions of Scripture or concepts and expounding what the Word of God has to say about these issues. And that's what we're doing today. For those of you who are wondering when we'll have our next gathering together, check out our website for updates about when we'll be getting together and actually having services here at 823 Cherry Street. So just watch the website. You'll see all the pertinent information there. But today I want to deal with golden nugget number 3. And it is a two-word expression that you hear often from people. Don't judge. I remember many years ago, I was sitting with my mother-in-law, and another person had come into the house, and we're sitting there having a conversation. And somehow the conversation got around to a subject that was a little edgy and was discussing somebody whose lifestyle was way out of bounds if you look at it from a scriptural perspective. And this person said to me, "Don't judge." And I looked at them and I said, "What do you mean?" Jesus said, "Don't judge." Now, I thought, okay, is that all Jesus said? And I proceeded to instruct them about what the Bible has to say about judgment. And so that's what I'm going to share with you, because I'm sure many of you have heard the same thing. Maybe you have said the same thing. And the Bible has a lot to say about judgment, but it's not this overwhelming, condemning type message. It's very simple, but we need to understand it. Now, if you would follow me to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 7, and let's look at what Jesus said, and I'm reading from the New Living Translation. Matthew, chapter 7, beginning with verse 1, Jesus said this, "Do not judge others, and you will not be judged." Now, many people read that and stop. You can't stop. Let's follow the process. You can't just stop. Let's see what else Jesus had to say about judgment. He said, "Do not judge others, and you will not be judged. For you will be treated as you treat others. The standard you use in judging is the standard which you will be judged by. And why worry about a speck in your friend's eye when you have a log in your own? How can you think of saying to your friend, 'Let me help you get rid of the speck or the splinter in your eye,' when you can't see past the log," or one translation says the railroad tie, "in your own eye? Hypocrite. First, get rid of the log in your own eye, then you will see well enough to deal with the speck in your friend's eye." So, don't judge. What does that mean? Does that mean that we are not to judge anybody ever for anything? And by the way, the word judgment, krino, is a word that simply means to look at something the way it really is, to properly ascertain what's going on. And so what about this concept, don't judge? Well, you know, it's interesting because many people believe that we're not supposed to judge, but yet Paul the Apostle wrote to the church at Corinth and admonished them because they did not judge. In fact, they had a situation in Corinth where there was a guy, and let me tell you right away, this was some crazy stuff. There was a man in the church at Corinth who was living in sin with his stepmother. In fact, this was so outrageous, Paul addressed it in one of his letters to the church at Corinth. Let me show you what he said. 1 Corinthians chapter 5. Again, I'm reading from the New Living Translation. Paul the Apostle said this, "I can hardly believe the report about sexual immorality going on among you, something that even pagans don't do. I am told that a man in your church is living in sin with a stepmother, and you're so proud of yourselves. But you should be mourning in sorrow and shame, and you should remove this man from your fellowship. Now, verse 3, Paul went on to say, even though I am not with you in person, I am with you in the spirit, as though I were there, and I've already passed judgment on this man. Well, evidently Paul didn't just take half of what Jesus said, don't judge, because he did judge. And let me speed up a little bit. And he said this in verse 6, 1 Corinthians chapter 5. Your boasting about this is terrible. Don't you realize that this sin is like a little yeast that spreads through the whole batch of dough? Get rid of the old yeast by removing this wicked person from among you. Then you will be like the fresh batch of dough made without yeast, which is what you really are. Now, Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed for us. So let us celebrate his resurrection or the feast, not with the old bread, but with the new bread. Now, he goes on to admonish them and said, look, I told you in another letter not to associate with people who are involved in sexual immorality. Now, let's stick to the subject of this concept, don't judge. And please understand that I'm not sharing this from a judgmental standpoint. You'll get this in a minute. Hang with me and you'll see it. Let me tell you a little story. Years ago, I was invited to minister in a church in the central part of the state. And this church had just gone through a huge scandal. It was bad. I mean, one minister had committed adultery with another minister's wife. I mean, the whole thing just blew up. And you might say, well, this stuff like this should never happen in the church. It happens all the time. Doesn't mean it should, but it does. And so I went up there to minister to mend broken hearts and to help these people heal from this terrible thing they'd just gone through. And unbeknownst to me, the other leaders of this group thought they were trying me out for a pastorate up there, that I was going to pastor this church. And that's not why I went up there. And so we had a little fellowship dinner after the service, and all these pastors come from all these different churches, and I thought, uh-oh, something's going on here. But anyway, they started to grill me about what I believed about morals and character and things like that. And so I said to them, look, I know what happened here, and I'm not trying out for a job. And they were shocked that I knew. They said, you knew? You heard about it? Well, what did you hear? I said, well, it's not important. And who knows, it may not even be true. But I proceeded to share with them this one thing that I want to share with you. I said, it's one thing to tell somebody, look, if you mess up morally, boom, you're done. You're out of here. I said, it's quite another thing to teach somebody how to live right. It's quite another thing to teach somebody how to use the tools that you find in the New Testament to avoid sexual immorality. And I said, I err on the side of prevention. I had a pastor years ago who said, you know, it's a whole lot easier to avoid a problem than clean one up. And so what I shared with these men and these leaders in this church organization was you need to teach prevention. You need to teach men who they are in Christ. You need to teach them how to walk out this love walk. You need to teach them how to consider other people, men and women, as being valuable and precious to God. And if you see them as valuable and precious to God, it'll change your outlook and the way you view them. And so I said, prevention is a whole lot easier than cleaning up a big mess. And so that's the standpoint that I'm using to address this issue with you. Not to be hard and judgmental. You know, thank God for my Pentecostal holiness friends. I consider myself to be as Pentecostal holiness as you can get. And but during my time in the Pentecostal Holiness Church, It was common to preach sin in the church, sin in the church. Got to get the sin out of the church. But they never taught people how to avoid it. They never taught people how to overcome. They never taught people who they were in Jesus Christ so they could live above it. And what we need to do is have a heart of compassion so we can help people. Help people. Help them live above it. Because living in sexual immorality will open the door to all kind of bad stuff in your life. Paul said this in his letter to the Corinthian church. He said, people who practice these things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Don't be deceived. And so where do we fall on this issue of judgment? Because if you take half of what Jesus said, don't judge, you haven't completed the thought and you're going to miss it. But what he said was, and he used this illustration in another passage, I believe the Gospel of John, judge with righteous judgment. In other words, if you're a thief, don't try to correct somebody else for stealing. What you need to do is get your own life right, realize who you are in Christ, repent, change, and then you can see clearly to help your brother who has a theft or stealing problem. And so what we need to do is just what Jesus said. Before we take an approach of trying to correct somebody else, and when I say correct, think of this word, help. Before we try to help somebody else who's struggling with an issue, make sure that we're walking in integrity. Make sure that we're walking in love. Make sure that we examine our own lives. And then use the power of his resurrection and the life of Christ in us to help our brother. Because if we leave them in that state, we're not helping them at all. All right? Now, here's what I want you to see. Paul said some things to the church at Corinth that we need to keep in mind when it comes to judgment. Remember, Jesus said, don't judge others and you will not be judged, for you will be treated as you treat others. The standard you use in judging is the standard by which you will be judged. Now, that's not a hard thing. If you allow the life of Christ to emanate from you, if you live your life by the word, if you're walking in faith, if you're walking in love, this is an easy thing to do. And I often say, the longer you do it, the easier it gets. It's not hard to live right. It's not hard to love your brother. It's not hard to stay away from sexual immorality. It's pretty easy if you'll just walk the word out in your life. I'm not saying you won't be tempted. We're all tempted. But being tempted is not a sin. It's what you do with it, how you handle it. All right? And so Paul actually admonished the church at Corinth because they didn't judge this situation. Now, he goes on to say this, 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Check this out. He said, when one of you has a dispute with another believer, how dare you file a lawsuit and ask a secular court to decide the matter instead of taking it to believers? Do you not realize that someday we believers will judge the world? Whoa! There's a big one. What did he say? Paul the Apostle said by the Holy Spirit that one day believers, that's you, that's me, would judge the world. Aren't we qualified to help people in small areas? Then he goes on to say in verse 3, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, don't you realize that we will judge angels? So you should surely be able to resolve ordinary disputes in this life. Wait a minute. We will judge angels? What a powerful statement. Now, that helps us to understand that we've had the wrong thinking about this judgment thing. Many people think, well, don't judge. That means you see a situation that's ugly, that's hurtful, that brings death and destruction, and you just ignore it. You leave it alone. No, no. We need to, from a heart of compassion and with a foundation of integrity and love, minister to people and help get them out of the ditch. help get them out of these situations that are killing them, that are destroying them. That's our responsibility. All right? Hey, that's all the time we have for this week. We'll see you next week on another edition of Faith is a Lifestyle. Until then, you keep putting your faith in God's Word.
Will you clap your hands right here? Come on. Come on, say with power and majesty.
Power and majesty, dominion, authority, you reign.
Sing it again, with power.
With power and majesty, dominion.